We want to complete the table using the function rule f of x equals the absolute value of x plus 2, and then use a table to graph the function. And if we found it helpful, we could replace f of x with y and write this as y equals the absolute value of x plus 2. But over time, we should get more comfortable using function notation here. So what we'll do is select x values, perform substitution, and then find the corresponding function value or y value. And every time we do this, we'll be finding a point that would be on the graph of the given function. Now, the more we know about the absolute value function, the better. This is going to be a V-shaped graph. One thing that's helpful to know, though, when sketching the graph of an absolute value function is, if we can determine which x value would make the absolute value 0, we want to select values that are less than and greater than that value. Notice when x is negative 2, we'd have the absolute value of 0. So I'm going to put negative 2 in the middle of the table, and then I'll select values that are less than negative 2 here and greater than negative 2 here. So I'll go ahead and use negative 3 and negative 4. These are smaller than negative 2. And then I'll also use negative 1 and 0, two values that are greater than negative 2. Now let's see what happens when we use these values. To determine the corresponding function value or y value when x is negative 4, we'd have to substitute negative 4 for x. So we'd have the absolute value of negative 4 plus 2. This is the absolute value of negative 2, which is positive 2. So the graph of our function would contain the point with an x-coordinate of negative 4 and a y-coordinate of positive 2, which would be this point here. Next, we'll substitute negative 3 for x. So we'll have the absolute value of negative 3 plus 2. Well, negative 3 plus 2 is negative 1. The absolute value of negative 1 is positive 1. So the graph of our function must contain the point with an x-coordinate of negative 3 and a y-coordinate of positive 1, which is this point here. And then when x is negative 2, y would be the absolute value of negative 2 plus 2. The absolute value of 0 is 0. So our function contains the point with an x-coordinate of negative 2 and a y-coordinate of 0, or this point here. And then for x equals negative 1, the function value or y value would be the absolute value of negative 1 plus 2. Well, negative 1 plus 2 is positive 1. The absolute value of positive 1 is 1. So our function must also contain the point negative 1, 1, which is this point here. And then lastly, when x is equal to 0, we'd have the absolute value of 0 plus 2. The absolute value of 2 is 2. So our function contains the point 0, 2, which would be this point here. Now if we go back and take a look at why it's helpful to select an x value here that made the absolute value equal to 0, notice this created the point negative 2, 0, which was this point here where the function actually changes direction. So when we selected points that were less than negative 2, we found points on this half of the graph. And then we selected x values that were greater than negative 2, we found points on this part of the graph. And now we can see the graph of our function is going to be a V shape, and it would look something like this. Now I do want to mention that we didn't actually have to select these exact x values. We can select any x values that we want. But when it comes to the graph of an absolute value function, we would have to determine enough points to determine the V shape of all absolute value functions. Notice if we only found these three points without these two points here, we might mistake this for a line when in fact all absolute value functions do form a V shape. I hope you found this helpful.